Here's just an example of a dig permit. I know it's real small. A lot of you guys are probably familiar with it, but there's a lot of stuff spelled out in there. How deep you can dig, how you treat the material, so forth. Because of that history and legacy that's at the site, we have to be careful with what we do here. Stormwater management. Okay, I'd mentioned before that our conventional approach is try to get that water off as fast as we can. We don't want to have localized flooding. We want to get it off and into our streams. And so the upper picture is actually fairly typical of the way that we did this in the past. We were really focused on flooding, so we were designing for often for like a 10-year event or larger. And so we got through that kind of design, we end up with this, our conveyance systems a lot like that upper picture where we have this concrete channel. Well, there's been a big change in our stormwater management approach as of late, probably within the last decade or so. And we're starting to use this term low impact development, or green infrastructure is another term that's often used for that. And so our regulations are finally now kind of catching up for some of those approaches. And so what it does is it's really focusing more on the water quality. So what that means is now instead of focusing on like a 10-year event, we're actually focusing on more like a 2-year or less, or even a 1-year type of storm event. And so we're also trying to minimize those hydrologic impacts. Before, when you build this, you're not worried about that stream receiving that velocity of flow. And it's going to receive a velocity when you get an event with something like the top. The bottom, you can see it's a vegetated channel. Now, that's designed to be for water quality. It's designed to improve the water quality benefits. So if you get that parking lot and you get that 2-month or 1-month storm that we get here starting about this time, we might get one this evening, that dust from the parking brakes, that maybe that little bit of oil or grease that drip from the cars, that's going to go into this. And this vegetation and the organic matter in there is actually going to treat that, and it's going to prevent those from getting to our stream. This doesn't have any of that kind of treatment at all. And so the idea is that we're designing these. Now, this is not going to handle a 10 or 25 year storm, is it? No. And so what we have to do is we have to design these differently. We have to have the profile that maybe is a lot wider. We also have to think about what happens when we get that 10 or 25 or 100 year storm. And so we have to have the banks go up. They might be sloped, it might be grass, so it looks more like a swale or something like that. And so the design is changing a bit, but the regulations are saying that we have to design more towards this than what's up above. This Energy Independent Securities Act, ESA is what it's often called, is the regulation that's driving federal facilities to do this. Okay? And in this, they say the sponsor of any, and this is important, development or redevelopment of more than 5,000 square feet. That didn't just say dig a hole or anything like that. Development or redevelopment. Okay, so that's the first key that triggers ESA, although you still have to do certainly erosion sediment control, but you might not have to do post-construction or permanent BMPs for that, for a site that's not development or redevelopment. So we need to do site planning, design, construction, maintenance, et cetera, for those to the maximum extent technically feasible. METF, as they call it. Now, what does that mean? There's a whole lot of challenges to what maximum extent technically feasible is, but the BMPs, the stormwater BMPs I'm going to show you, are considered on a list of BMPs that are maximum extent technically feasible. So, we're trying to control the pre-development hydrology. So I showed you that little graph that had the little bump in the green one. That's the pre-development hydrology. And after we have the post-development hydrology. And what this is saying is we have to make that orange one that was really peaky like that match that green one. Okay? It's not easy to do, by the way. It's not easy, especially if you're doing large development. So from a designer's engineer designer standpoint, that is a challenge. And we use all kinds of tools to get there. But also I wanted to point out that now we're looking at controlling temperature, which I mentioned before is a pollutant, the rate of flow, the volume of flow, and the duration of flow. So again, remember when I showed you that hydrograph, which is that peaky graph there, it was really narrow and really high. That narrowness was that timing. And so it also says that we need to start matching the time of that pre-development type of hydrograph, which was a lot longer And then, of course, the peak was a lot shorter. So these are the regulations that are driving our design, especially on federal facilities. Now, EPA has gone through and done some interpretation of this, and so has GSA and DOD and others. So here's just an example of some of the interpretation that on the left that GSA has done. On the right is the health, safety, and security. I'm actually pretty familiar with what DOD is doing because I've done a lot in terms of, I was helping EPA try to interpret what that policy meant. And so I've done a fair bit of training on Department of Defense properties and how it's interpreted. And this is kind of, this is actually from the DOD stuff, but it's actually being interpreted very similar for GSA and others. This is kind of that language in there. You have to meet pre-project hydrologic conditions. Pre-project, not necessarily pre-development. Okay, that's one interpretation. So that means whatever it was before you did your project, that's your pre-project development or scenario, right? So you have to match that. So if it's a parking lot and you're changing it to something else, it's still impervious, you don't have to follow quite the same rules. EPA wasn't actually very happy with that DOD interpretation, and so they're still negotiating on some of that. Some of the other aspects about it are what is maximum extent technically feasible? By the way, EPA originally came out and said cost is not a reason for it not to be technically feasible. And so they were not allowing you to say, well, that technology just costs too much, so we can't do that. They said that's not a valid excuse. You have to be able to treat this to what we have technology that matches that treatment. So part of that was this full employment of, and then these practices. This first one is called bioretention. And we have that actually here in some of our design manuals. Anybody use the Urban Drainage Volume 3 for post-construction BMPs? Has all of these kinds of best management practices. So if you're interested in some of these or want more information, that's probably one of the best sources. And I'll talk a little bit, show some examples of what bioretention is. They have another one called permeable pavements, cisterns, recycling. That's kind of a water reuse, which is frowned upon here in Colorado because of our water rights, and so not allowed here, at least yet. And then green roofs. Has anybody seen a green roof? Seen what they look like? Where'd you see yours? EPA building, Region 8, downtown. Huh? In his backyard. Yeah. I have a shed that looks like it has a green roof on it sometimes, too. Anybody else seen green roof? Any? Yeah. Is there?
Yeah.
I didn't know about that one. Okay.
A company that designs them, and so they have one on the top of their building.
I didn't. Oh, I bet you I know who that is, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm glad you mentioned that. I'll have to check that out. Peterson Air Force Base, green roof.
Did they ever do the one in Buckley?
They're working on the one in Buckley. And so it's been a learning process here about green roofs. Right now, they're fairly costly, but they're working on trying to get those costs down. It's an interesting technology. What's that?
Cheyenne Mountain.
Yeah, that's the ultimate green roof, right? So the other parts. So if the design objective cannot be met within the project footprint, this is again coming from DOD. LID measures may be applied at nearby locations. So this is basically saying if you can't do it on site, you can still do it within your facility. So for DFC. If you can't do it right where you're working, you might be able to mitigate it somewhere right off site. That's the DOD interpretation. Doesn't work for the private world. It's special because you guys have control of all of your land within those borders. So so that's kind of a part of the ESA and how Department of Defense is interpreting it. So how EPA has said that maximum extent technically feasible and matching pre-development and post-development hydrology. Well, so how many of you guys go out and pull out a stormwater a model and you go and say, well, I know what the Denver rainfall is. I'll just get it for the last 30 years and I'll run it through this program and I'll determine what that matching hydrology is for my post-development versus my pre-development based on my plans. How many of you guys do that? What? Nobody does that? Of course not. That's way too difficult. Only nerds like me try to do stuff like that. So what we did is EPA put together this interpretation and said, well, let's call that around the 95th percentile storm event. We did a bunch of sites. We actually modeled doing exactly what I mentioned for about 12 sites across the country. One of them actually was here. A post office up in Westminster was used. Again, we were looking at federal facilities and trying to determine what that looks like. Or you can match pre-development hydrology, which means you can go back and use one of those models and go through all the steps that I just mentioned. That's obviously going to be the harder method, and you're going to probably want to pay someone to do that. So the easiest one is infiltrate the 95th percentile storm. All right, 95th percentile storm. So that means the storm event that occurs about 95% of the time or less. Okay. So that means only 5% of the storms are larger than that. Anybody venture to guess what that might mean for Denver area, the Denver region?
5%?
No, the 95th percentile. So it's how many inches of rain is that? Huh?
Trace?
Yeah, on an annual basis.
Trace to half an inch.
So you say half an inch is that maximum, and you say 2 inches. Okay. Well, the answer is somewhere in between those. So the actual 95th percentile in this area, by the way, it's 1.1 inches. So that means 95% of all of our rainfall events are 1.1 inches or less. Only 5% are greater than that. I see some people like, really? We don't get any rain here, that's right. What's our annual average, roughly?
Rain?
Yeah, rain. Rain.
It's like
15? 20? It's actually 14.8. See, I get,
15.
This is what kind of nerd I am. I have these numbers right off the top of my head. So it's about, depending on where you are, because it does vary even in the Denver region, it's about 14.8. So, which is near desert. It's a semi-arid climate for sure. So some of the interpretation of what EPA did here, so they're talking about using specific stormwater control practices to meet that maximum extent technically feasible. And it says that the federal facility must use all known available and reasonable methods for stormwater retention or reuse. By the way, so that 95th percentile, that's retain on site. No flow from that whatsoever. 1 inch. So that's what you're looking at, exactly. You're looking at trying to infiltrate that. That means you have to have soils that are able to do it. That means you have to be able to store it from whatever drainage area you're talking about. If it's a parking lot, rooftops, et cetera. So that's what we're doing as engineers. We're designing those calculations saying, okay, this is how much we need to have to capture 1.1 inches off from whatever surface it is. Okay? And we're capturing that, and then it's, how is it going to get lost? It's either going to go in the ground, it's going to evaporate. Maybe if you have something that's called a bioretention, you get plants to uptake the water and to what they call transpire it. So those are kind of the techniques. These are the regulations that the Denver Federal Center is facing in terms of its stormwater design. So what kind of stormwater management solutions? You guys are probably familiar with a lot of these. I actually put pictures up here of this one is that bioretention. So you can see that it has that vegetation in it. These are supposed to be more distributed practices. So the first ones up there, the dry pond, wet pond, those tend to be our big practices, right? Those tend to be the big ones that capture that large event. These other ones over here, like bioretention, or in Colorado, we used to call them porous landscape detention. Does that resonate with anybody? Porous landscape detention? That's what used to be in the guidance. It's the same thing as bioretention. We do use a lot of these around. I know in my house, I can think of about 4 or 5. We mentioned green roofs. This other technology called porous pavement, pervious asphalt, paver stones. What we do is we design a storage reservoir underneath it. It's used more commonly here. It was actually first installed at a Safeway out by Aurora in 2006. Anybody know anything about that? So what happened is they had a bad installation, as it turns out later we know about. But what happened is it started raveling fairly quickly after about a year and a half or so. And Denver Urban Drainage Flood Control District says, whoa, wait a minute. Let's not put any more of this technology in. And so they put a moratorium on it. And so they went through a forensic engineering analysis to see what happened. And it turned out it was just not a great mix. That the installer was not as familiar with it. it's which is kind of funny because now the person that did that is in charge of the organization that promotes that that type of technology. And so they've learned a lot. It's actually come a long way. It's, you know, it's doing things where it's, I was just doing a workshop last week where we were presenting on this stuff in Omaha, and they're applying it all over the place. And it's using different binders. It's a drier mix. But what it has is it ends up having about 20 to 30% void space, usually 20 to 22%. They're tightening the specifications on it. And that means that actually about 100 inches per hour can drain through this. It doesn't look like it. And you look at the core, when you see a core and you see the kind of the void spaces, but you can go out there and pour water on it and it just drains right through. It can be fairly effective. It takes a little bit different operation maintenance once it's in. And so you got to keep that in mind if that's what you're going to use. So, and then some of these others that we've used before, sand filters, perimeter filters, wetlands, grass swales we're pretty familiar with. Rain barrels, again, if we consider this is Colorado and we have water rights issues, we can't collect that technically. It's changing, actually. There's Denver Urban Drainage right now is doing a study right now for a cistern that they put on the Denver Green School. Anybody know where that is? It's on... it's just south of the Science Center, about 2 miles or so. And what they're doing is they're capturing rainwater. They're using it to irrigate the plants. By the way, does anybody know how much water we use that's potable water? We clean it up so that we can drink it, and we put it on our plants. We clean it up so much that we can drink it, and we put it in our toilets. And then we have things like water restrictions and irrigation restrictions when we have droughts.
Isn't CU designer, they have a system?
There's a lot of different systems.
There again, it's with the laws.
Yeah.
Where they're bypassing, they're saving all your, like your dishwasher, your kitchen sink,
right.
Your shower water, bath water, stuff like that.
Yep.
And then holding a tank and...
They and use it as you need it.
Like down to a third, a residential used to a third in a year because that they'll pipe it into like your toilet tanks and stuff like that, and then you'll have it for your own irrigation too if you ever want.
That's right. That's true. You get yes. So I'm going to bring up your point next. So keep that in mind. Yes,
but
the law says we can't do that. That stemmed from a public health reason. And some of those laws are changing too. So that's what we call gray water reuse. If you're using your sink water, your shower water, your laundry water, things like that, that's gray water as compared to black water, which is our toilet water. Okay? Yeah, that's happening, and they can cut it down to actually a tenth in many cases of your water use. And there is a CSU professor that has installed it at his house. His name's Larry Rosner, and did a study on it. He was actually recording a lot of information on it and so forth. They also have one on the CSU campus that goes to a wetland. And so they're treating it after it's gone through that system and just putting in the wetland for polishing, essentially. But you're right. So it's a public health issue is why it hasn't happened before. Now, your point. You said, well, Denver Water is going to hate this. You know, we're going to be reducing our water. That's what they make their money is, how we pay money. Well, you said that. One of you guys said that. I heard it right over here. Sorry, I didn't want to attribute that. But you're right. So that's another issue. But what happens is the rate structures start changing over time. And by the way, I don't know if anybody saw this. I saw it in my water bill recently. I got a little thing that says conservation helps. And so what they've done is they're trying to actually price the water so that we use less. Is essentially what it is. Is you know that first little bit is cheaper, but as you use more and more and more, it gets more expensive. I don't know if you guys ever look at your water bill and look at that stuff.
A couple years ago, and it worked real well, and then they raised the rates.
They raised the rates because they couldn't pay for their overhead.
So this is where there's a balance, because we're struggling on how to figure out, for instance, the gray water use and that kind of stuff. So not less towards the stormwater management, but it is actually a conservation kind of measure, something to think about.